अस्सलाम वालेकुम, वेरी गुड मॉर्निंग टू आवर एस्टीम्ड गेस्ट एंड अदर पार्टिसिपेंट्स। आई वेलकम यू टू द सेकंड डे ऑफ वेबिनार एंड मिस्टर बशारत विल फॉर्मली इंट्रोड्यूस टुडेज सेशन। ओवर टू यू मिस्टर बशारत सर।
Thank you, Ashik Saab, but perhaps our resource person has not joined it yet.
You
Ashik
start, he
Saab?
will join, sir.
Should I start or should we wait for
Yeah,
him?
you start, he will be joining.
Okay. Assalamu alaikum and a very good morning to all of you. Revered Principal, Government Degree College, Bijbehara, Professor Nighat Fatima, our worthy resource person, the speaker of today's session, Professor Dr. Geer Mohammad Ishaq Sahab, dear faculty members and dear participants, I welcome you all on the second day of this 3 days national webinar. It is an honor in itself to host such a beautiful and learned group of academicians, scholars, and students. On behalf of my college, I welcome you all. Thank you for giving us your precious time. Thank you for joining us today. It is a delight to have you with us. And special thanks to those who, in spite of network issues, are joining us. Before I hand over this session to our worthy resource person, let me have a brief introduction of our speaker. Dr. Geer Sahab is presently working as Associate Professor at Department of Pharmaceutical Sciences, University of Kashmir. He has been working there from last 18 years. Presently, Geer Sahab is also holding the charge of Head Department of Pharmaceutical Sciences, University of Kashmir. Dr. Geer Sahab has also served as drug officer with the government of J&K for about 3 years prior to joining University of Kashmir. He holds doctorate in pharmacology and has research interest in pharmacovigilance, pharmacy practice, pharmaceutical care, drug utilization, quality control, and rational use of medicines. He has many research papers, many abstracts, many conferences, and many seminars to his name. At present, Dr. Geer Sahab is also dispensing his additional duties as Coordinator, Human Resource Development Center, University of Kashmir. Geer Sahab has been very instrumental in formulating the only drug policy of Jammu and Kashmir and has worked tirelessly to get it implemented, which has unfortunately not been implemented yet. Recently, Geer Sahab has been appointed as advisor to the Pharmaceutical Price Monitoring and Regulating Committee of Drug and Flood Control Organization of J&K. Undoubtedly, Geer Sahab is the most able and appropriate person among the academicians of J&K to deliberate on this issue. I welcome you, Geer Sahab, and I thank you for joining us. Over to you, sir.
Thank you very much, Professor Basharat Sahab. It's a matter of honor and privilege for me to be talking during this three-day webinar on illicit drugs and mental health, which is being organized by the Government Degree College, Bijbehara. I wholeheartedly thank Professor Nighat Fatima, Principal of the Government Degree College, Bijbehara, conveners Dr. S.M. Zubair, Dr. Selfie Muzaffar, Organizing Secretaries Professor Abdus Salam Dar Saab, Dr. Mehraj Ahmed Bhatt, Professor Shaukat Ahmed Malik Saab, for organizing this webinar and for inviting me as a resource person at this occasion. So dear friends, colleagues, respected faculty members from Kashmir and outside Kashmir also, I wholeheartedly welcome you to this particular session, which will be dealing with the need for multidimensional approach in tackling this menace of drug abuse. So, of course, as you all are aware, that drug abuse is, has assumed a monstrous and alarming proportions. Mr. Hilal Ahmed Dar, please stop presenting. So is my voice clear to all of you, Mr. Moderator, Dr. Basharat Saab? Am I clearly audible?
Yes, sir, you are completely audible, sir.
Yes, sir, right. Yes, sir. You are audible, sir. Yes, sir.
Thank you. So this the menace of drug abuse has assumed alarming proportions, monstrous proportions, and which is quite visible. Not only it has assumed dangerous proportions within J&K, but when we look at the global level, at global level per se, it has assumed very alarming and dangerous proportions of late. And very recently, United Nations Office for Drug and Crime has published the World Drug Report of 2020, World Drug Report 2020, which comprehensively deals with all the issues related to this particular menace, and which draws a holistic picture of how big the problem is. So, when we look at this, now I will share my PowerPoint presentation very shortly with you. For that, I have to get connected using another device. So, meanwhile, this particular today's this year's theme of the International Day Against Drug Abuse and Illicit Trafficking, which is being celebrated worldwide annually on 26th of June. This year's theme is Better Knowledge for Better Care. As you all are aware, yesterday, Dr. Nilesh from Maharashtra spoke at length about various issues of this problem. Particularly, his focus of main attention was the employability and employment. So I happened to attend that lecture also. Now, this day, the International Day Against Drug Abuse and Illicit Trafficking, it is, this day was chosen by the United Nations General Assembly way back in December 1987 to commemorate Lim Zhengzhou's dismantling of the opium trade in Humane Guangdong. Humane Guangdong is a place in China where the this dismantling of the opium trade was done, was accomplished, and this was accomplished by Lim Zhengzhou. In order to commemorate this accomplishment of dismantling of the opium trade in Humane Guangdong, this particular day was commemorated by the United Nations General Assembly in 1987. And since then, this is being celebrated worldwide as the International Day Against Drug Abuse and Illicit Trafficking. So the importance of this day is that there is need for solidarity and compassion. There is need for collaboration worldwide. And there is need to create awareness. There is need to create more information and educate people about the dangers of this scourge, about the dangers of this menace. So that's why this particular day is being celebrated worldwide as an international day, so that more events are organized, more education is spread, more awareness is created, how to deal with this problem, how to manage this problem, and what are the repercussions, what are its consequences, and what are the latest figures regarding this particular problem worldwide. So that's why this particular day is celebrated as an International Day Against Drug Abuse and Illicit Trafficking. And when we look at the world picture, when we look at the global picture, globally, some 269 million people are believed to suffer from this disorder. See, this disorder, unfortunately, has got some kind of taboo, some kind of stigma attached to it. But it has been very well accepted that this is a preventable, avoidable, treatable disorder. It is a mental, psychological disorder which can be treated, which can be avoided by suitable healthcare interventions. So this, people are not only fighting against the menace, but people are also fighting against this stigma, against this taboo, which is being attached to this particular disorder, because of which people do not get adequate care, and they don't get adequate, modalities by which they can overcome this menace and overcome this disorder. So worldwide, around 269 million people suffer from this particular disorder, which is 30% more than that was prevalent in 2009, 10 years back. Around 35.6 million people across the world are victims of drug abuse, according to this particular World Drug Report of 2020, which has been published by the United Nations Office on Drugs and Crime. So 35 million people worldwide are victims of this drug abuse. And, 269 people use drugs. 35 million people are the ones who are suffering from the disorder, who are suffering from the malaise, the disease. So international, these organizations are celebrating these occasions to educate the public on issues of concern, to mobilize political will and resources to address this global problem and to celebrate and reinforce achievements of the humanity in overcoming this menace. Unfortunately, young adults and teenagers account for the largest share of those using drugs, and most of them suffer from HIV, hepatitis C, and many other communicable diseases. So this disease is breeding many other diseases like HIV, hepatitis C, and other communicable diseases. The most alarming fact is that only 1 out of 8 people who need treatment and rehabilitation are able to get it. Only 1 out of 8 people. 7 out of 8 people do not get adequate treatment, do not get adequate rehabilitation, which they need to overcome this problem. And this is a very alarming scenario, because if 7 out of 8 people are not able to get the required treatment, then where are we heading towards? Where is the world body heading towards? So that is the world picture, that is the global picture, the prevalence of this particular disorder, the global scenario. Now, so far as the definitions involving this particular disease are concerned, there is a lot of confusion in relation to the definitions, the terms used also. Some people say addiction, some people say dependence, some people say substance abuse, some people say misuse. So let's make these things clear for a while. For those participants who are not very well aware of all these terminologies and jargons. So I will try to explain to you what are these various terms, what do these various terms mean. First of all, dependence. Dependence is of two types. Dependence in simple terminology means depending upon something. You know, you become dependent on something and you're not able to avoid this dependence. So this dependence could be of two types, physical dependence and psychological dependence. Physical dependence is the one wherein if you stop taking a particular drug, you start getting physical problems, you start getting physiological abnormalities. So the person starts getting a withdrawal syndrome or abstinence syndrome. What is a withdrawal syndrome? Withdrawal syndrome means, suppose a person has been consuming a drug for a long period. The moment he stops taking the drug, he starts getting symptoms, he starts getting signs, he starts getting discomfort. For example, he starts getting shivering, palpitations, sweating, tremors, restlessness, sleeplessness, etc. That is what is known as a withdrawal syndrome or an abstinence syndrome. So when somebody is using a particular drug for a long period and he is not able to withdraw it, soon after withdrawing it, he starts getting these abnormalities, these signs and symptoms. We call it physical dependence. However, psychological dependence is the one which is there in the psyche of the person, which is there in the mind of a person. The person may not necessarily get those physical signs and symptoms, but psychologically he starts feeling restless, discomfortable. He starts feeling anxious, distrust. That is what is meant by psychological dependence. And the other term used for psychological dependence is addiction. Addiction is the other term used for psychological dependence. While as only dependence is the other term used for physical dependence. Physical dependence is the one where there is a withdrawal syndrome or an abstinence syndrome. There is another term which is often used with the with the consumption of drugs, that is tolerance. What exactly is meant by tolerance? Tolerance means that when upon consuming the drug, the dose which you had consumed the previous night is not showing the same results this today. So for upon continuous use of the drug, when you have to go on increasing the dose of the drug, that is what is meant by tolerance. That is the body is getting tolerant to the drug And in order to get the same effect upon repeated dosage, one has to go on increasing the dose. For example, we use morphine in cancer patients for relieving of pain. In order to get pain relief in that particular cancer patient, we have to go on in gradually increasing the dose. And at one point of time, the whatever dose you use, it may not show any effect at all. So that is what is meant by tolerance. Now, so far as drug dependence is concerned, it may not always be a correlate of drug abuse. That is, a person who abuses a drug may become addicted. But an addict always abuses a drug, but a drug abuser may not always become a drug addict. So that is where we need to understand what is meant by drug abuse. So drug abuse or misuse includes all types of non-medicinal, non-approved, inappropriate, or illicit uses of a medicinal drug. When a medicinal drug, which is meant to be used for therapeutic purpose or for medicinal purpose, is used for any kind of non-medicinal purpose or non-approved use, or is used inappropriately in an illicit manner, in an illegal manner, illegitimate manner, we call it drug abuse or drug misuse. For example, even if a patient takes a drug without a doctor's prescription, that is what is meant as self-medication. That is also referred as drug abuse or drug misuse. But what is substance abuse? So when we say substance, it includes non-medicinal substances also. Substances which are not meant for medicinal use. For example, volatile substances, solvents, alcohol. So improper and illicit use of non-medicinal drugs and substances like solvents, alcohol, other volatile agents is known as substance abuse. So drug abuse means the illicit use of medicinal products, inappropriate use of medicinal products, while as substance abuse means illicit, inappropriate, improper use of non-medicinal products. And therefore, drug addiction is a term which is used to refer to compulsive, relapsing drug use in spite of negative consequences, in spite of the discomfort. A person continues to use a drug compulsively, and at times it is triggered by cravings for that particular drug. The person craves for it. He keeps on, you know, craving for the drug, and that is what is meant by addiction. Now, coming to the, so that I have made the definitions clear, and we have also discussed a bit about the global scenario of drug abuse. Now, let's come to the local scenario that is within J&K. What is the situation of drug abuse within J&K? Within J&K, only yesterday you might have seen in the press, there was a press report that 17,000 people abused heroin in Srinagar and Anantnag. A study has found that in two districts, some 2% population suffers from drug abuse, which amounts to around 17,000 people. And around ₹3.7 crore is being spent on drug abuse every day in these two districts. Unfortunately, 45% of the substance abusers use intravenous drugs, with 91% of them using IV heroin as the main drug of abuse. And more than half of these drug addicts also live with hepatitis C, and approximately 1 in 8 persons lives with HIV among these drug addicts in these two districts. So this is the latest study which was reported only yesterday, and the main reasons which were attributed in this study to drug abuse were peer pressure, boredom, lack of recreational facilities, psychological stress. These were the primary reasons for the drug abuse. And there was another report last year which said that there has been a 1,000% rise in drug abuse within just 3 years at only one of the drug addiction centers, which has been established at SMHS Hospital, Srinagar. Over a period of 3 years, this said particular drug addiction center at SMHS had witnessed almost 945% rise in the patients. 489 patients visited this OPD in the year 2016-17, while as this figure jumped from 489 to 3,622 in 2017-18. In 2018-19, 5,113 patients visited the OPD of this drug addiction center at SMHS Hospital, Srinagar. So now we are witnessing that more than 5,000 patients are attending only one single OPD of one single addiction center at a local hospital here. So this is quite a very alarming and dangerous trend, wherein there used to be only 500 OPD patients some 3 years or 4 years back. Now we have more than 5,000 patients visiting each day. So the picture is very grim and the picture is very alarming, which calls for a multidimensional approach from all stakeholders of the society, which calls for immediate action. From 116 patients in 2014, the number has risen every year at this particular drug addiction center. 203 in 2015, 207 in 2016. So earlier, where there was the abuse of prescription drugs was more prevalent earlier. Prescription drugs means tranquilizers, sedative hypnotics, painkillers. So drugs used for inducing sleep or drug used for relieving pain, drugs used for tranquilizing a patient, calming down a patient, an agitated patient. Earlier, there used to be misuse of these kinds of drugs, which was highly prevalent. But the most dangerous thing is that now it is shifting to opioid, misuse of opioid drugs. Heroin use is the maximum number of patients have been found to be using heroin, and that too intravenous injectable heroin. So the trend is very shifting very fast. While there was prescription drug abuse too more prevalent earlier, now it is the opioid use which is more prevalent. Heroin use, that too injectable heroin, and injectable opioids are misused now. So when I say opioids, what I mean by opioids? Opioids means those which are obtained from the opium poppy, from the plant of flowering tops, from the fruits of opium poppy. And that includes drugs like morphine, codeine, oxymorphone, hydromorphone, oxycodone, and hydrocodone. These are opioids which are being misused, particularly heroin, diacetyl morphine. Heroin is nothing but diacetyl morphine. So there was another study by Kashmir Lifeline a few years back, which said that around 10% of children between the age of 15 to 19 consume medicinal opioids. 10% of children aged between 15 to 19 consume medicinal opioids. That is through by using cough syrups like Corex and all, which contains codeine, and by using earlier the capsules like Spasmoproxibon, which contain dextropropoxifene, which has now been banned. Similarly, in this particular study by the Kashmir Lifeline also said that in rural Kashmir, children smoke cannabis, marijuana, which is also known as charas. And the chemists supply drugs like sleeping pills, codeine, and Spasmoproxibon to 55% of the drug abusers which were interviewed by them, while as 37% were supplied by the drug peddlers and 8% were supplied by the hoteliers, daba walas at tourist hubs. So now that most of you are teachers working in educational institutions, so we need to be cautious about the vicinity of the educational institutions, the hawkers, the ready walas, and who sell ice creams and all. And we need to be very cautious what they are doing and what kind of activities they are indulging in. So here comes the surveillance part, which I'll be discussing later, how the surveillance can be enhanced. Now, this particular study also found that during a survey that 17% of the drug abusers are in the age group of 12 to 20 years. So children as young as 12 years have also been found. And in fact, last year, an 8-year-old boy had reported to this particular OPD addiction center at SMHS Hospital. And even a 45-year-old female had reported of having used intravenous heroin. So earlier we used to say that drug abuse is more prevalent among illiterates, among uneducated people, among those who are jobless or who do not belong to good families. This is what was the general notion earlier, but now the latest figures which are coming up show that even educated people, graduates, postgraduates, even people belonging to well-off families, people who are, you know, well-educated, literate, they are also getting trapped into this menace, and which is very unfortunate. An alarming 25% of graduates and postgraduates have been found to be indulging in drug abuse by this Kashmir Lifeline survey, and that is very alarming. Now, you know, when these drug addicts, when they sell these drugs or when they use these drugs, there are very fancy names which have been attributed to indicate these drugs. So as teachers, we must be aware what fancy names, you know, sometimes people talk in coded language. We must be aware what's going on. For example, for a drug known as amphetamine, they use a fancy name or a pseudonym of Speed or Biliwiz. Speed or Biliwiz is used for amphetamine. For dextroamphetamine, they call it Dexies. For methamphetamine, its other name is crystal meth or ice. For another drug, methylphenidate, it's also known as Ritalin. Then one of the most commonly used drugs by these abusers is MDMA, which is methylene dioxy methamphetamine or ecstasy. It's also indicated by the name of Candy or Malcolm X. Similarly, so this ecstasy or Malcolm X was, you know, it was reported to have been sold by some hawkers outside some schools. When a few years back, when a civil society group did a study at a very prominent school of the region, of the valley, they found that 35% of young adults, 35% of students from class 9 to 11, 12th were suffering from drug abuse problem. 35% of students. And most of them were using either amphetamine or methamphetamine. So this Candy or Malcolm X was also being used. Then there is this another drug, which is LSD or lysergic acid diethylamide. Which is lysergic acid diethylamide, and another drug is tetrahydrocannabinol, which is obtained from cannabis, that is obtained from bhang or charas. So that the active ingredient of this bhang is THC, that is tetrahydrocannabinol, that is the active principle of cannabis indica or marijuana. So let me, you know, I hope you know the difference between bhang, ganja, charas and hashish, which is quite often used in this parlance. So let me explain a bit. Mr. Sartaj Altaf, please stop presenting. So let me explain a bit what is meant by this, what is the difference between bhang, ganja, charas and hashish. First of all, their active ingredient is tetrahydrocannabinol, and they are obtained, this tetrahydrocannabinol is the active principle of the plant cannabis indica or cannabis sativa, which is the common name is marijuana. This has been the most popular recreational and ritualistic intoxicant used for several decades, its use has spread worldwide. So what is bhang? Bhang is the dried leaves of this particular plant and is generally taken by oral route and acts slowly. So bhang is also used in some religious ritualistic festivals like Holi and all. So this acts slowly and is taken by oral route, comprises of dried leaves of cannabis indica or cannabis sativa. Then ganja is the dried female inflorescence part of this plant, which is more potent and is smoked, and its effects are produced instantaneously. Third part is the charas, which is the dried resinous extract obtained from the flowering tops and leaves of this plant. The dried resinous extract obtained from the flowering tops of this and leaves of this plant. This is the most potent form and is smoked with tobacco. And the other name for charas is hashish. Now, cannabis is the drug of abuse, which is having lowest acute toxicity. So this is sometimes also referred to as a soft drug, while as heroin and cocaine are referred as hard drugs. Heroin is also known as smack or brown sugar. The smack or brown sugar is the other name for heroin, which could be white powder or brown powder. A powerful depressant and a very addictive substance. that produces a sense of euphoria, warmth, contentment, detachment from the emotional and physical stress, and has withdrawal syndrome also. That is, upon withdrawing, it causes nausea, vomiting, sweating, runny nose, tears, shaking, sleeplessness, muscle ache, and body pain. So when a person stops taking this drug, heroin, which is mostly given taken intravenously, you can identify a drug addict with the marks of those needle marks on his arms because of frequent injections of this heroin. So upon stopping the drug, he suffers from a whole lot of problems like nausea, vomiting, sweating, runny nose, tears, shaking, sleeplessness, muscle ache, and body pain. Life for these patients becomes a very endless cycle of seeking money, then procuring the drug, then using it and suffering from its symptoms, and again searching for money. This vicious cycle needs to be broken somewhere, and then only we can stop this menace. The overdose of this particular drug, heroin, can result in death due to respiratory failure. It has got severe effects on respiration, and due to respiratory failure, it can cause instantaneous death. And even, you know, acute dose of this drug, if somebody takes an overdose, he instantly dies at the particular spot. There have been some photographs making rounds on the social media wherein people have been seen lying on the washrooms and near these hospitals and all because of the overdose. Then the cocaine. Other names for cocaine are coke, snow, rock, crack, and Charlie. These are the other names for cocaine, which is an alkaloid extracted from the coca leaves. And this is a drug which interrupts the conduction of nerve impulses and also acts like an anesthetic. It interrupts the conduction of nerve impulses. And this is also a powerfully addictive white powder that produces an intense rush that lasts for around 15 to 20 minutes. It is snuffed and snorted. It's absorbed into nasal tissue and then enters the bloodstream and quickly enters the brain. The problem with these drugs is that they are highly lipid soluble, lipophilic. Therefore, they can cross the blood-brain barrier and they can reach the brain instantly, and they can produce the effects which will last for around 15 to 20 minutes. And sometimes this cocaine is processed with ammonia or baking soda so that it can be smoked. Then there are other opioid drugs which are being abused or misused, which are obtained from the opium poppy, which are, some of them are naturally occurring opioids, others are semi-synthetic opioids, and some are totally synthetic opioids. The naturally occurring opioids include morphine and codeine, while as semi-synthetic opioids include heroin, oxycodone, oxymorphone, hydrocodone, and synthetic opioids include buprenorphine, methadone, fentanyl, and cocaine. Now this buprenorphine is also used as an antidote in drug addicts, in drug de-addiction and rehabilitation centers. We make use of buprenorphine and methadone as antidotes, which cause this more discomfort upon consuming the drug. If somebody withdraws, there is a lot of discomfort. And if somebody uses the drug again. So these drugs are used as antidotes. Then methamphetamine, which is very commonly used, which is a central nervous system stimulant, CNS stimulant, it produces euphoria, psychosis, seizures, depression, aggressive and violent behavior, dramatic weight loss. Am I audible?
Yes, sir, you are completely audible, sir. Go ahead.
Right.
Sir, you are audible and absolutely audible, sir.
Yeah, there was some slight I'm sorry, I couldn't use my... I had a PowerPoint presentation also, but that was supposed to be used using another device. But somehow there was some issue with the second device, which it was not getting connected, because of which I couldn't use my PowerPoint presentation. I will try once again, meanwhile, to get connected through the second device so that I can show my slides also.
It is going good, sir. It is very informative.
Thank you very much. So I hope you are able to understand everything that I'm trying to say. Now, so far as amphetamine is concerned, It produces euphoria, psychosis, seizures, depression, aggressive violent behavior, dramatic weight loss, dilation of pupils, disturbed sleep patterns, and nausea. Nausea means feeling of vomiting. So this is a drug which has been one of the most commonly used drugs is this amphetamine and its dextroisomer dexamphetamine, which is also commonly known as Dexy among the parlance of these drug addicts. You know, there's an interesting thing here I want to tell you. There is one drug which was being used by the drug addicts of Chicago, which was known as MPTP. MPTP stands for N-methyl-4-phenyl-tetrahydropyridine. So in a nutshell, you can call it tetrahydropyridine. This tetra-MPTP or methylphenyltetrahydropyridine was a drug of abuse among the drug addicts of Chicago. But this, you will be surprised to know that this drug led to the discovery of the cause of Parkinsonism, a disease in which there is trembling, there is shivering, there is loss of tone of muscles, rigidity of muscles. The person's body keeps shaking and shivering. So, you know, paralysis, agitans, there is a lot of shaking, paralysis, tremors are there. And the root cause of this Parkinsonism was found to be certain oxidant-producing substances, certain substances in the atmosphere, in the occupational hazards, which come into our body, which enter into our body and lead to the production of certain oxidants, oxidizing free radicals. And those free radicals damage the neurons, damage the nerves, which in turn leads to Parkinsonism. So damage to the neurons of the limbic system in our brain. And this MPTP, it was deducted from this particular drug MPTP, because in those drug abusers, when it was studied how the damage is caused, it was seen that MPTP is getting converted to MPP, which is a free radical, that is methylphenylpyridine is a free radical. And this free radical is damaging the neurons, it is destroying the neurons, which leads to Parkinsonism. So some credit also needs to be given to these drug addicts of Chicago, because of whom the MPTP was found to be the root cause. And then many other free radicals were discovered subsequently. And the treatments which are available are based on this particular analogy, that it is because of the damage caused by free radicals. So coming back to my own PowerPoint, so this was just, just for your interest, I was telling you, you know, how the drug addicts can sometimes also prove to be beneficial, though this menace can never be said to be beneficial in any manner to the society, to the individual, to the nation, or to the whole community. This has disastrous connotations, disastrous manifestations, and there is only harm, nothing else is there. So, you know, by the time when a person initially starts taking this drug, he feels good, he feels euphoria, that is feeling of well-being. He feels elated, he feels rushed, he feels the high. But upon continuous usage, there is tolerance. That's why I explained the term tolerance to you. That is, one has to go on increasing the dose in order to get the same kind of excitement, in order to get the same kind of rush and the same kind of high. But then a point reaches when the drug becomes totally ineffective. And then the other symptoms start coming up. The symptom of tremors, trembling, palpitation, sweating, fainting, becoming unconscious, sleeplessness, and then that is when the drug addict wants to get rid of this drug, but somehow it is too late. So we need to aware people that, you know, we should come out of this menace well in time before it is too late, before it starts causing a lot of devastation in our lives and it starts hampering everyday routine and we get detached with our families, with our society, and we are typecasted or stigmatized, as is prevalent, unfortunately, in our society, as addicts. So better late than never. An ounce of prevention is better than a ton of cure. So here, prevention is very, very important. And now let me take you to the volatile substance abuse. This is very highly prevalent in schools and colleges and educational institutions. In one of the cases, a boy was found to be looking at his notebook. The notebook was kept open, while as the teacher was thinking that he is reading the book or the notebook, but he had pasted some kind of solvent over the pages of the notebook and he was sniffing it. And this is what we need to be aware about, alert about, and we need to be cautious about, because these volatile substances are, you know, many things come under this ambit. Some people use nail polish, some use boot polish, some use thinners, some use petrol, some use gum, some use glue. Some use this ink removing these fluids. So, you know, there are a whole lot of substances which come under the bracket of solvent abuse, because these are volatile substances which contain gases or chemicals that evaporate at room temperature to form a vapor which can be inhaled. So this is also known as solvent abuse and is found in a whole lot of legal household products. For example, nitrous oxide, also known as the laughing gas, this is usually dispensed from small metal canisters and is inhaled from balloons. So laughing gas is one of the such substances. Then butane gas or propane gas, this is found in cigarette lighters, the cigarette lighter refills and aerosols. They contain this butane gas, which can be inhaled, which gets evaporated, which can be consumed. Then alkyl nitrates are also known as poppers. Petrol, sometimes even petrol can become, person can become addicted to the vapors of petrol. And some other industrial glues, which are there in the gum sticks, in the these ink removers, and even nail polish. Nail polish contains acetone. And you know, this boot polish contains acetone, or you know, even this ink removers contain toluene. So toluene, acetone, butane, nitrous oxide, these are all volatile substances, solvents, which can be abused. And they are found in everyday products, in our household items. So one needs to be very cautious about, you know, what, how do they act? Most of these are central nervous system depressants. They depress the central nervous system. And you know, this way the person gets detached from the reality. He tries to get some solace from his day-to-day stress, anxiety, and from his tension. And that's why they, or just for the fun of it, just for the high of it, they consume these substances. Now coming to the de-addiction, way back in 2017, we presented a drug de-addiction policy to the then health minister on October 3rd, 2017, a comprehensive, now later on the government adopted a new drug de-addiction policy last year, but we had also presented a draft through a civil society group to the then health minister on October 3rd, 2017. Now the main aim of this drug de-addiction policy was REAR, R-E-A-R. So what is the name, full expansion of this mnemonic? REAR means stands for research, A stands for aware, E stands for enforce, and R stands for rehabilitate. So we have to do research, what kinds of substances are being used, what kind of damage is being caused, what are the causes, what are the effects, what is the pathophysiology involved. The research has to be done. What is the prevalence? What is the epidemiology? What percentage of population is suffering? And what are the main root causes of this problem? So research is the first step. Then you have to aware the people, educate the people about its ill effects, about its harm, about its consequences. And you have to, you know, hold seminars and events like these in order to make people aware about the dangerous consequences of these drugs. Then you have to enforce the policy. Once the policy is there, based on the research which has been generated, based on the evidence that has been generated, that evidence has to be converted into policy, and that policy has to be converted into action. So we have to enforce it. We have to implement the policy. Just having policies doesn't work. We have to implement them somewhere. Then once we implement them, we have to put it into practice, and we have to rehabilitate the people who are already suffering from it. Now here I would like to say, as educational, you know, as educationists, as teachers, how can you deal with students suffering from this problem? You have to divide them into three groups. The students who are yet to be exposed, you know, mostly the students take is because of peer pressure, because of the first use phenomena. That is, they want to see what happens on first use, how it feels, what kind of high a person gets, out of curiosity. So though the first group is those students who are yet to use, who are yet to experience it, and who need to be kept away through awareness programs, by awareness programs, by educational programs. We need to keep them away from this. That is the first group of students. Then second group of students comprises of those who have used it, who have already become abusers, but symptoms are not yet open. Symptoms are not visible. They have not become clinical. So that is the second group of students who have started using it, but symptoms are not quite manifest. They have not started experiencing all the discomforts, and that is the second group. Then third group is the one in which they have become the abusers, and they have also experienced the symptoms. Now they are under severe discomfort, severe distress. They want to get rid of it. So first we need to divide, and we need to devise separate modalities, separate policies for these three group of people. For those who are yet to experience it, we have to keep them away by education, by surveillance, by awareness, by giving them good recreational facilities, good counseling services, and by giving them good educational services, good sports facilities through which they can exhibit their talent and get attracted towards lucrative things, towards better productive things. That is the first group. Second group is those who have become abusers but are not yet symptomatic. We have to get them back. We have to quickly make them a return. And for this can be done by motivating them, counseling them, and understanding them through compassion. We don't have to boss over them or become judgmental and start abusing them or stigmatizing them. But we have to show compassion. We have to show sympathy, and we have to become counselors. We have to turn into caregivers. And that, Ms. Taslima Banu, please stop presenting. So we have to become caregivers, and then that's how we can bring them back into the mainstream, away from this drug menace. And third group is those who need to be rehabilitated, and we can rehabilitate them by having adequate de-addiction centers, by having adequate rehabilitation measures, by giving them drugs through which they can come out of this, by giving them antidotes which can prevent them from using this drug further. So we can talk more about this. We have elaborated upon these three kinds of measures in that policy which we had given to the government. So I am now trying to present my PowerPoint slide, and I hope this becomes visible to you now. So there has to be a three-pronged strategy in tackling the drug menace. One is supply reduction, second is demand reduction, and third is harm reduction. You have to address all the three areas simultaneously. You have to reduce the supply, you have to reduce the demand, as well as we have to reduce the harm. So how do you go for supply reduction? Supply reduction means reducing includes all kinds of broad range of strategies and actions which are aimed at stopping and minimizing the production, manufacture, and distribution of these illicit drugs. You have to minimize their production, their manufacture, and their distribution. That is what is meant by supply. So this India is squeezed between golden triangle and golden crescent, which are the hot hubs of this illicit opium cultivation. Golden triangle comprises of countries like Iran, Afghanistan, and Pakistan. This is the golden crescent. And the golden triangle consists of the countries on the other side, towards the eastern side, that comprises of countries like Thailand, Laos, and Myanmar. That is the golden triangle. So India is sandwiched between golden crescent and golden triangle, which are hot hubs of cultivation of opium. So India is the transit route, particularly Kashmir. So J&K, these drugs coming out from the golden triangle are transported through Kashmir. So India, including J&K, is a transit route. So they are very prone to these substances of abuse. Therefore, supply reduction has to aim at curbing, controlling these trafficking areas, controlling these transit areas, transit channels, and curbing the supply of these drugs through these areas. And also curbing the cultivation, manufacture, and distribution. So that is what is meant by supply reduction. Then demand reduction means range of policies and programs which seek a reduction of desire and preparedness to obtain and use illegal drugs. So you should create more awareness, more education to reduce the desire, to reduce the craving, to reduce the desire to have the drug and use it, and the preparedness to use it, to buy it. So by illegal means, demand has to be curtailed by creating more awareness, more education about its ill consequences, and by stopping the by counseling the people not to use it. Then the third part is the harm reduction. In that, we include policies and programs that focus directly on reducing the harm and resulting from the use of illicit drugs. We try to reduce the harm which has already been done. So we try to de-addict the people. We try to rehabilitate the people who have already suffered from the drug abuse. And we try to give them as much relief as possible. That also includes making them stand on their own feet, making them earn their livelihood, giving them vocational training so that they can earn their livelihood, making them realize their own potential, their own strengths, and overcome their weaknesses. So this includes a whole lot of psychotherapies, whole lot of counseling, whole lot of these behavioral therapies. So we need to give these therapies, and simultaneously we need to give them drugs by which they can, for example, if somebody is using alcohol, we can give him disulfiram, which builds up aldehydes and causes discomfort if he takes that alcohol again. Similarly, buprenorphine or this methadone is used for heroin addicts. So that is what is meant by harm reduction. So all these simultaneously, we have to use these supply reduction, demand reduction, and harm reduction measures by which we can overcome. So the policy which we have given to the government, that included all the three types of measures, various types of measures required for supply reduction, harm reduction, as well as demand reduction. Now let us look at the causes now. What are the main causes of this problem, particularly in the context of Jammu and Kashmir? What are the chief causes which lead to this problem? Drug dependence is not something, as I said earlier, which is incurable. It is a very much preventable and treatable disease. So effective prevention and treatment measures will become useful in controlling this menace. We need to have effective prevention and treatment interventions. And the best results are achieved when a comprehensive multidimensional approach is adopted. What do you mean by a multidimensional or multidisciplinary approach, which I have been talking about repeatedly? It includes a diversified pharmacological and psychosocial interventions. We have to do interventions at social level, psychological level, pharmacological level, economic level, as well as political and administrative level. So when all these levels are clubbed together, psychosocial, economic, political, administrative, as well as pharmacological, then we call it a multidisciplinary or multidimensional approach. Because the children and adolescents who suffer from neglect, abuse, household dysfunction, exposure to violence, instability, conflict, they are more prone to substance abuse. And that is the reason why Kashmir Valley has become a major cause of drug abuse, because the most of the etiological factors or the causative factors are attributed to the long-standing conflict in the region, turmoil in the region, frequent phases of unrest, unemployment, illiteracy, a very stressful social life, educational and family stress. There are frequent disruptions in education, examinations. People have to study on their own. There is family stress. There is unemployment, illiteracy, lack of sports amenities, lack of recreational and entertainment avenues. There is easy availability of scheduled prescription drugs over the counter. You go to any drug shop and purchase any drug without a prescription, most likely you will get it. Nobody will ask for a prescription. Though this prescription drug abuse has decreased now, and opioid drug abuse has increased dramatically. So then there are other causes, like there are certain select areas which are turning out to be hotspots of illicit drug use. Within Srinagar city, we have certain hotspots like in Nauhatta, in Malkha, near Barzula, and near Sora, Anchar, etc. So we need to understand what are the psychological, demographic factors and social factors because of which these are becoming hotspots of drug addiction. Then there is lack of effective enforcement mechanism and government control. Some people accuse even police of promoting drug abuse. And there is mushroom growth of licensed drug stores and large-scale corruption and growing immorality in the society. So these are some of the causes which have been attributed by various researchers to drug abuse, particularly in the context of Jammu and Kashmir. But I believe these reasons may hold good for other regions also. For other participants from other areas will enlighten us. This may be, I think consumed my time, but I would request the organizers give me a few minutes more. Is it okay if I continue for a few minutes more?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Okay. Yes, sir. No issues.
Thank you very much. So I have 5 minutes till 12. So maybe within 5 or 10 minutes, I will try to conclude. Thank you very much.
Okay, sir. We will ask a question is only through chat mode. You will collect them and answer them. We will.
Okay. No issue. No issue.
We will not use audio option.
All right. So now, so far as the stigma attached to these drug addicts is concerned, you know, it is often believed that drug addiction is a self-acquired affliction. The person himself is responsible for drug addiction. So it is his own creation. But this is a wrong notion because it is a disease, it's a disorder. And people who get, into this trap, they never know how they got into it. They first start with a cigarette and then, you know, it goes on increasing. And it starts from a cigarette or one single puff. Then they don't know where they have landed ultimately. So we need to take it as a preventable, avoidable, treatable disease rather than a stigma, rather than a taboo. And we need to control it at multidimensional levels. We need to include all stakeholders of the society. In the policy which we had submitted to the government, we had enumerated the role of the excise department, police department, education department, healthcare department, agriculture department, and even the role of the civil society, role of the religious preachers, role of the traffic policemen. We had enumerated the role of all the people in that policy. Everybody has to come forward and contribute and collaborate. Then only it will become possible to control this menace, because it has a lot of multiple dimensions. And unless all stakeholders come together, join hands and contribute, it is very hard to overcome this menace. Then there is need for social reintegration. There is no need for compassion. There is need for a collaborative approach. First of all, what is the role of family and teachers? A major role comes upon the family and the teachers, because supportive families are essential to raising socially, mentally, and physically healthy individuals. And factors such as lack of security, trust, and warmth at a home, at a family, is the main reason for drug abuse. A lack of structure in family life, inappropriate discipline practices, insufficient limit setting among children who are at greater risk. So inappropriate family skills training, that all can lead to drug abuse, risky behaviors. So there is need to adopt an innovative approach among the families and even at the educational institutions. Teachers are second only to the family. So if a person, a drug abuser, does not find a friend in the family, he can find it in the teacher. So teacher can be a counselor, a mentor, a friend, as well as a caregiver. And he can counsel the patients. He can try to understand his problem and tell him how to identify his strengths and overcome his weaknesses, which often lead to drug abuse. So teachers can be of great help in detecting, identifying, counseling, hand-holding, supporting, encouraging, and even remedifying these drug abusers. But there is need of regular awareness. We need to train the teachers how to counsel them, how to approach them. There is need for psychiatric counselors. There is need for psychological counselors at the educational institutions. So we can educate people through outdoor camps, through open-air theaters, drama, painting competitions, video displays, street plays, etc., in order to make them aware of the consequences of the problem and how to overcome it. And awareness about the ill effects will go a long way, because these drugs not only affect your physiology and psychology, they can make a person, you know, handicapped, they can make a person mentally retarded, and, you know, a person may lose his masculinity or may lose, you know, his kidneys may get damaged, liver may get damaged, whole lot of problems are possible. So when we explain it out to the students, then what kind of problems you may face, so obviously they would not go to, most of them would not like to go towards that bottomless pit. It is a bottomless pit. A person can freely go towards it, but it will be hard to come out. So it is very difficult to come out of it. A big role has to be played by the educational institutions, and the surveillance has to be maintained. CCTV cameras have to be installed in the vicinity of the educational institutions so that they can keep an eye on the movement of these traffickers, on the movement of these suppliers who supply substances of abuse. very important to have CCTV cameras, because they can, you can sit and detect who is doing what. And then the measures need to be taken by the government by adopting a policy, by implementing a policy, by creating more drug de-addiction facilities, by having more rehabilitation centers. See, Punjab model is a very effective model in this respect. Punjab has adopted a pyramidal approach, a conical model, in which at the bottom level, there are community centers, at the broad base centers, at the level of the first aid centers or the sub centers, the community health centers. Then at the secondary, well, at the community level, they only receive patients in the OPD. Then at the intermediate level, they have both OPD and IPD facilities. Intermediate level includes sub-district hospitals and district hospitals. Then at the tertiary care level, they have the tertiary care hospitals where they need to rehabilitate these people, and they need to tackle the complicated problems, complex issues. So they have a conical approach, a pyramidal model. Lower level, we have these community health centers and sub-centers and first aid centers. At the intermediate level, they have the sub-district hospitals, district hospitals, and maternity and care centers. And at the tertiary level, they have the tertiary care hospitals. So this model needs to be adopted. We need to have rehabilitation centers in every district. We need to have de-addiction centers in every district. And we need to have counseling centers at every sub-district level, at block level. So there are many more measures. Unfortunately, I don't have time to elaborate upon those, which a government can take in order to curb this menace. So drug sale licenses should not be free for all. Schedule X drugs should be strictly banned, and you know, they should be kept, given only on the prescription of a doctor. Records have to be maintained, and OTC sale of prescription drugs has to be stopped. Then intelligence apparatus has to be strengthened. We need to understand where from these drugs are coming. Social interventions need to be made by including religious preachers, civil society groups, the local panchayats and the local mohalla committees. They, in particularly in vulnerable pockets, hotspots, we need to involve the elders, village elders, mohalla elders. And by their cooperation and collaboration, we can reach out to these drug addicts and try to counsel them. So these are the various components of drug abuse treatment which I have mentioned. Family services required, child care services required, vocational services required, mental health services are required, medical services, educational services, legal services, financial services, and housing services. A whole lot of services need to be made available in order to adopt this multidimensional, multidisciplinary approach of tackling the drug menace. And that can only be possible when this policy, comprehensive, robust policy framework is there, which is implemented well in time and which is adopted. So the vicious cycle of what is the, lastly, I will tell you about this vicious cycle. That is the behavior, the feelings give rise to behavior. Behavior gives rise to thoughts, and thoughts give rise to more feelings. So this vicious cycle needs to be broken. The feelings which give rise to drug abuse, which convert into a behavior of drug abuse. And this cognitive behavioral therapy is what breaks this vicious cycle. That is the vicious cycle of wrong feelings, wrong behavior, and wrong thoughts, which lead to the drug abuse behavior, drug abuse pattern, needs to be broken by cognitive behavioral therapy, by counseling, by psychological counseling. Group therapies can be arranged, and one-to-one therapies can be done. And lastly, what are the 10 reasons which should keep a person away from drug addiction? What are the, this is for the students who are attending this particular lecture. What are the 10 top reasons which should take you away from the drugs? Number one, physical addiction. You will be physically addicted to this. That means you will become dependent. Your integrity, your character will be lost. Your integrity, your independence will be lost. Your self-reliance will be lost. You will be physically addicted to these drugs. If you stop taking the drugs, you will feel a lot of discomfort, a lot of problems. So why to make yourselves dependent? Number two, emotional addiction, psychological addiction. Emotionally, you will become dependent on these drugs. Psychologically, you will become dependent on these drugs. You will feel restless. You will feel gap. You will feel that there is something lacking, something missing, no matter how much money you have, how many other facilities you have in life. So why to make yourselves emotionally dependent? Third reason which should stop you from taking drugs, expensive habit. This news report had said that each packet costs around 1,000 rupees, and this supplier sells around 25 packets in one of the hot spots each day, making around 25,000 rupees. So today you may need it only one packet. To maybe after a few days you may need two packets because of tolerance. After a few days, three packets. So it's a very expensive habit, which can lead a person to theft and to other criminal activities. Fourth reason we should keep you away: destroys your health. It causes kidney problem, liver problem, central nervous system problem, breathing problem, shivering, tremors, restlessness, insomnia, etc. Then fifth problem, fatal accidents, because drugs impair your psychomotor performance. You cannot drive properly. You can cause accidents and you can ruin others' lives. So fatal accidents may be caused. Then sixth reason, you will be liable to face arrest. For mere possession of a drug, you can be imprisoned for 10 years. Narcotic Drugs and Psychotropic Substances Act of 1985. There is a provision for imprisonment up to 10 years if you merely possess a drug more than 2 grams. So mere possession, even if you have not used it, just you are possessing it and having it with yourself, is a crime, and more than 10 years of imprisonment can be awarded to you. So why to face arrest when you are free, when you are happy and with your families? Seventh reason, face arrest for other drug-related crimes. If you do accidents, if you drive irrationally, if you commit theft or other criminal activities, you may face arrest. Eighth reason, it destroys your own potential. You may be a good writer, you may be a good reader, you may have a lot of talent as a singer, as a painter, but this will destroy your own potential. And you will not be able to visualize your own potential anymore. But you could have risen to the zenith of your career and you could have earned laurels for yourself as well as for your community, but this will destroy your own potential. The ninth reason for avoiding drugs destroys one's personal relationships. Your own relatives, your own friends will stay away. Your own family members will stay away and they will stigmatize you. You will be isolated and it will destroy your personal relationships. And the last reason, it will end in an overdose. Lastly, when there is tolerance, you will keep on increasing the dose. Finally, you will end up in an overdose. And overdose of a drug can even cause respiratory failure, cardiac failure. It can cause a stroke and it can lead to death of a person. So the end point of all this is death. So therefore, I urge upon all the people to spread more awareness, more education, and tell the people about the ill consequences of the drugs, so that awareness is created and people are kept away from this menace. Thank you very much for your patient audience. I'll be happy to take any questions.
Dear participants, if anyone has any question, he can write down that in chat window. Sir will answer the questions.
I can see one question by Mr. Zubair Sofi. Standard operational procedures are there, but in this part of the world, who bothers? So strict implementation of rules is required. But again, we may have more ways of creating voids in rule sets, as in India, rules are meant for poor, while as rich go away untouched. This question has been written by Mr. Zubair Sofi. Yes, standard operational procedures are there. And policies are also there. Last year, government of J&K has adopted a drug de-addiction and rehabilitation policy. But what is needed is implementation of the policy on the ground. So as I have been saying, that evidence of generation of evidence through research should be converted to policy. It should be documented as a policy. Once the policy is there in a documented form, it should be converted into practice. That is, it should be implemented on ground. If a policy is not implemented, it is of no use. So evidence should lead to policy. Policy should lead to practice. Of course, we need to have more SOPs, more de-addiction centers, more rehabilitation centers, and we need to have more manpower. We need to have more equipment to tackle this menace at district level, village level, block level. And of course, this is going to work by creating more awareness, more education. So then Mr. Anis Alam is saying that religious teachings given to a child can play a major role to stop this menace. What is your view on this? Yes, of course, I completely agree that the religious preachers have to emphasize in their religious sermons, in their Friday sermons, in their churches, in their temples, wherever they are preaching, that they have to urge upon the people to address this menace, to identify the abusers, to be compassionate towards them, to try to solve their problems and try to counsel them so that it can be overcome. A huge role has to be played by the religious preachers, no doubt. They're a very important stakeholder. Then Mr. Buran Ahad is asking, what are the chances of psychiatric medication turning into substance abuse, particularly in case of panic attacks? And are there any alternates to psychotropic drugs? See, as I said, drug abusers cannot always become drug addicts, though drug addicts are always drug abusers. A person who has become addicted to a drug is an abuser. But even if there, you know, when we say physical addiction and psychological addiction, psychological dependence means addiction. Physical dependence is only dependence. So as long as, for example, somebody takes bronchodilators to get relief from asthma, he may become physically addicted, but not psychologically addicted. Similarly, somebody taking vasoconstrictors, so he may also become physically addicted, but somebody taking anti-epileptic drugs, if a person stops taking anti-epileptic drugs, he will get withdrawal syndrome. He will start getting seizures. So that means he's physically dependent, but not psychologically. Similarly, these psychotropic drugs, which we use to relieve anxiety, depression, schizophrenia, mania, etc. It's not necessary that all the people will become addicted to these drugs. If they take these medicines in accordance with the prescription, in accordance with the directions of the doctor, they will not become addicted. They will only get beneficial effects. They will not get harmful effects because doctor will tailor the dose. Doctor will see where they are experiencing any adverse effects. So he may substitute the drug with another drug if there are any adverse effects. And if the doctor feels that there are any addictions, then he can switch over to another therapy. So these patients who are using psychotropic substance drugs, who are using psychiatric medications, antidepressants, anti-anxiety drugs, or any other psychotropic drugs, they need to be in constant touch with their doctors. Wherever they are feeling any adverse effects or addiction, they need to report it to the doctor so that he can adequately adjust and modify his drug therapy. But there is no worry that they need not worry that we will become addicts. Huh? If people are using these drugs on their own, resorting to self-medication, or you know, they are when the doctor had told them to stop, they are continuing to use the drug for sleep, for relieving anxiety, or for any other relieving pain, they can become addicts. If they are using it on their own without doctor's prescription and advice, they can become addicts. So self-medication should be avoided, and continuous usage of the drug should be avoided. Then Mr. Burhan Ahad has also asked the same question which I have replied just now. Then Anis Abdullah, you're giving the lot of examples of drugs. My question is that by giving such examples through webinar, can't these examples prove fatal as the drug addicts are in search of such drugs which relieve them as per their wish? Sir, I believe that we are addressing a community of educated people over here, which comprises mostly of teachers and some scholars as well as students. So awareness is key to prevention. We need to make these people aware. If we do not make them aware of its ill consequences, we will be failing in our duties. But for making them aware about the ill consequences, we have to obviously name the drugs. We have to tell what are the ill effects of heroin, what are the ill effects of cocaine, what are the ill effects of psychotropic substances. Unless we name the drugs, it will not be possible to tell them about the harmful effects. And even if we don't tell them, abusers can find ways and means to find out which drugs to use. Abusers do not search it on Google to find out which drug they have to use. The abusers get it from supply chains. The abusers come under peer pressure mostly. And then they resort to misuse of these drugs. So what our focus has to be on prevention rather than hiding the facts from them. Hiding the facts will not serve the purpose. We have to make them aware of the facts. And then we have to take them away from this menace by telling them the facts, the ill consequences, the damages, and where they will land ultimately. Even I said the end point is death. So when these things are made clear to people, obviously they will not go into that direction. But for educational purposes, I'm a pharmacologist. I have to talk about the drugs and their ill effects. There is no other way out. Then Mr. Vakar Bhatt is asking, no one need any prescription for any drug in rural areas. Even drug addicts are pharmaceutical. Raw opium, poppy, husk, and heroin are now easily available, and alcohol is going to be legalized now. So he says that there is no need for any prescription, and many drugs are available without prescription, particularly in rural areas. Raw opium, this poppy husk and all is being used. Yes, as the studies have revealed, which I mentioned in the beginning of my talk, that in rural areas also this is becoming a menace. Over-the-counter sale of drugs is a big problem which needs to be controlled by the Drug and Food Control Department. They need to come out with effective strategies, more frequent inspections of the shops as well as their records. And these NRX, the doctors have to mention NRX on the prescriptions of these psychiatric substances. And these prescriptions have to be, copies of these have to be preserved by the drug retailers. And they have to show these records periodically to the drug inspectors. I have myself served as a drug inspector for 3 years before joining the University of Kashmir in 2002. So I know, you know, if the regulatory departments are strict in their actions, they can maintain good records and they can help in this. Mr. Hansal Shafi is asking, people don't come forward who are usually addicted. They always fear to come to the de-addiction centers. What is your say on this? How they can bring can be brought to these centers so that they can be given counseling? Yes, there is a taboo associated, you know, when a de-addiction center is being controlled by police. For example, we have a drug de-addiction center at the police headquarters. But so people may feel, you know, they may feel apprehensive that I will be nabbed or I'll be arrested or I'll be booked under law. So and then they may not even come forward in the hospitals. See, that is why our drug de-addiction center at the SMHS hospital till recent times was named as a community health center, as a community center. It was not even called as a de-addiction center. So as to facilitate the entry of people who are suffering from this problem, so as to facilitate the treatment of people suffering from this problem, that is, we need to make it public that those addicts who want to be rehabilitated, who want to be counseled and who want to be treated, they will not suffer from any you know, unwarranted consequences, and they will be given all kinds of relief, legal support, they will be given medical support, and they will be given counseling at these centers. The authorities need to make it abundantly clear through public awareness programs, through press, through print media, and they need to keep helplines on which these people can contact. Of course, there is a helpline at SMHS hospital as well as one helpline at the police de-addiction center. So these helplines will be very effective in counseling the patients, in reassuring them, in reinforcing their confidence on these drug de-addiction centers. First of all, the policy itself needs to make it clear what these de-addiction centers are meant for and what kind of things will be done, what kind of treatment will be given. When the policy is clear, that policy is made public, people are reassured and doubly reassured that no harm will be done to them unduly, and then only, you know, people will turn up in larger numbers. So is there any other question? I think I have answered most of the questions which have been there in the chat box.
So you can take one last question before winding up if you want.
Yes, yes, please. If there are any, somebody wants to ask on the using the mic, please allow it. All right, Mr. What are the chances of psychiatric medication turning into substance abuse? I have answered it. Vakar Ahmad, no need. He says that without prescriptions, drugs are being sold. Hansal Shafi also, I have answered. Yeah, Mr. Naveed Anjum, what about who went against drug peddlers? but arrested by police in Sopore. Where is administration? So I don't know about this particular case, who was the person who went against drug peddlers but was arrested. I don't know what are the nuances of this case and what are the pros and cons. So it will not be appropriate for me to comment because I don't know about this particular case. Mr. Malik Ishfaq is asking, how can we differentiate between hard and soft drugs? See, as I told in the beginning of my lecture, that charas, ganja, bhang, they are usually referred as soft drugs, while as cocaine, afim, this heroin and all, more opioids are known as hard drugs because of the hard effects. These charas, ganja, bhang, they may not produce very acute, severely acute adverse effects, but heroin, cocaine, opioids will produce very severely acute adverse effects. That is the difference between the two. Nevertheless, both are harmful. Soft as well as hard drugs are harmful. If this ganja and charas can also cause a lot of side effects on the central nervous system, on the concentration, learning, memory, and you know, a lot of discomfort. So both are harmful, but of course there is some difference so far as the intensity of the adverse effects, the severity of the adverse effects is concerned. There is some difference between the two. And the last question, Mr. Imtiaz Ballu, we need to aware our society not to use drugs, but tell them the benefits of sports activities. We have to tell them the focus on sports activities. Yes, of course, we need to, as I said, the drugs mar the actual potential of the abuser. A drug abuser may be a good sports player, maybe a good writer, reader, maybe a good painter, or maybe a musician, a singer. So we need to bring out that talent among those people. The teachers have a big role to play in bringing out that talent. And we need to provide them good recreational sports facilities. Lack of recreational facilities has been cited as one of the reasons for drug abuse. And, you know, because we are in constant turmoil conditions, lot of shutdowns and lockdowns. So this also leads to some sort of mental distress. So people need to be brought out of this mental distress. They need to be provided with adequate recreational facilities, sports facilities, other amenities at educational institutions and in societies so that they can relax and enjoy. And, you know, we need to hold these painting competitions, writing competitions, singing competitions so that people can get adequate chances to show their talent. Thank you very much. Is there any other question?
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you for such an elaborative, informative, and interactive session. It is always a great learning experience listening to you. Now I hand over to Mr. Ashik Saab for the formal vote of thanks. Over to you, Ashik Saab.
On behalf of Principal Government Degree College Bijbihara and entire fraternity of the institution, I extend a really hearty vote of thanks to our chief guest, Dr. Geer Mohammed Ishaq, who spared time from his busiest schedule to grace the occasion. I must mention our deep sense of appreciation for his explanation of the topic, need for multidimensional approach to tackle drug abuse in Jammu and Kashmir. I would like to thank all the participants for cooperating and not presenting during the session. At the last, I would like to thank Mr. Basharat Ahmed for moderating the session, and I hope our revered guest will provide us time in future also. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much for inviting me and Professor Basharat Saab, Asif Saab. Sure, I will always be available. Very recently, I delivered a talk at Government Degree College, Anantnag. It's always a privilege and a pleasure to be with the young learners as well as with the faculty members whom I often happen to meet at the Human Resource Development Center. Thank you very much for inviting me. It has been a very nice experience. Thanks a lot.
Thank you very much. Thank you, everybody. See you soon.